everyone. Welcome to worship in this beautiful sacred space of Skinner Chapel. Welcome to all those who are gathered here in person and also to those who may be joining us online. A special welcome this morning to Reverend Nathan Gonzalez, who will be leading us in worship again, and also to Kevon Rambuquele, who will be gracing us with his musical talents this morning. Just a couple of announcements. Due to the holiday, the church will be closed on July 4th and Friday, July 5th. So if you have any business in the office, take care of it before then. We have an opportunity for community on Friday, July 12th, will be our next community meal. It'll be a picnic-type meal with hot dogs and salads and ice cream for dessert, so come and enjoy some community and fellowship. Are there any other announcements to be shared? If not, we will continue with worship.
Good morning, everyone. Very happy to be here today. Please, if you're able physically and spiritually, stand with me. Listen to the call to worship. Come, all who are weary and burdened, seeking healing and hope. We come with faith, reaching out to touch the hem of God's garment. God's grace knows no boundaries, welcoming all who seek His grace. We come ready to receive God's mercy and love. Let us worship the Lord who heals and saves us, embracing us with the boundless grace of Jesus. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we gather in your presence with hearts full of gratitude and anticipation. We come before you seeking your healing touch and your boundless grace. As we lift our voices in worship, may your Spirit move among us, breaking down barriers and drawing us closer to your heart. Open our eyes to see your glory. Open our ears to hear your word. Open our hearts to feel your love. Empower us to embrace your message of inclusivity and acceptance, knowing that your grace is sufficient for us. Bless this time of worship, and may it be a blessing offering to you. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, who welcomes all with open hearts. Amen. Let us worship the Lord with hymn, Amazing Grace.
Thank you.
You may be seated. Let us read our words of assurance. Through life, passion, death, and resurrection, and the resurrection of Christ, we are assured of the forgiveness of our sins. No matter who we are, we are welcome from where we go. Nothing can separate us from the love and grace of God. Just as the woman with the issue of blood was healed by her faith, so too are we healed and restored by our faith in Jesus Christ. His sacrifice on the cross and his triumphant resurrection guarantee our salvation and inclusion in God's family. Beloved in Christ, know this truth. You are forgiven. You are healed. You are loved. You are included in the boundless grace and mercy of our Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Let all that I praise the Lord with all my heart. I will praise his holy name. Let all that I am praise the Lord. May I never forget the good things he does for me. He forgives all my sins and heals all my diseases. He redeems me from death and crowns me with love and tender mercies. He fills my life with good things. My youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord gives me righteousness and justice to all who are treated unfairly. He revealed his character to Moses and his deeds to the people of Israel. The Lord is companionship and merciful, slow to get angry and filled with unfailing love.
Our second reading today is from the Old Testament book of Lamentations, chapter 3, verses 22 through 33. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul that seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. It is good for one to bear the yoke in youth, to sit alone in silence when the Lord has imposed it, to put one's mouth to the dust, there may yet be hope, to give one's cheek to the smiter and be filled with insults, for the Lord will not reject forever. Although he causes grief, he will have compassion according to the abundance of his steadfast love, for he does not willingly afflict or grieve anyone.
Morning. This is the New Testament, Mark 5, 25 to 34. A woman in the crowd had suffered for 12 years with constant bleeding. She had suffered a great deal from many doctors, and over the years she had spent everything she had to pay them, but she had gotten no better. In fact, she had gotten worse. She had heard about Jesus, so she came up behind him through the crowd and touched his robe. For she thought to herself, if I can just touch his robe, I will be healed. Immediately the bleeding stopped, and she could feel her body that she had been healed of her terrible condition. Jesus realized at once that healing power had gone out from him, so he turned around in the crowd and asked, who touched my robe? His disciples said to him, look at this crowd pressing around you. How can you ask who touched me? But he kept on looking around to see who had done it, and then the frightened woman, trembling at the realization of what had happened to her, came and fell to her knees in front of him and told him what she had done. And he said to her, daughter, your faith has made you whole. Go in peace, your suffering is over.
Title for my sermon this morning is No Barriers for God's Grace. Lord, let the meditations of my heart and the words of my mouth be acceptable to you, my Lord, my Redeemer, in whom I hope. Amen. I've been here for 3-4 weeks so far, officially as the summer pastor. Ministry has run for a long time in my family. My mother is a pastor. She's a minister in Puerto Rico. My father was a pastor. I have lived my entire life in the church. Today, I'm not 24 or 34, as you might think. I am 43. I actually will be 44 in 2 months. But I felt a strong call into the ministry at an early age. And after that, I became a teenager, and you know how teenagers go. Church and ministry didn't become as important as trying to find myself to be more appealing to some individuals around my classrooms in school and my friends. So, you know, I went up to college, and when I was in college, I found myself again with a strong call in my heart to become a minister. So in college, I committed myself to pursue God's call, and I fell in love with the idea of becoming a pastor. During my college years, I loved preaching the gospel to other students and doing Bible studies with my classmates, and we had a chapel, not as beautiful as this one, of course, but I will go there sometimes just to pray for guidance. During my time in seminary, I loved spending my nights awake, delving into the truths of the Word of God. When I finished school, I felt like I was in the top of the world. And I was there because God had called me. I was doing that for Jesus. And all my life, I loved being a pastor. In reality, there's few other things that I enjoy more. I actually enjoy being an educator, if you will, as much as being a pastor. I enjoy being a father more than anything else in the world. I would rather just do that, just send my kids to school and spend my summers with them and spend every day with them. I would love that, but you know, life happens. I feel proud to say that my dad was a pastor. I'm excited to think that maybe my son and my daughter in the future might be like, hey, Dad, I want to be in ministry. I love preaching. I love deepening the Word of God and speak the truth of the Scripture. I like making strategies to grow church and meeting with people. I enjoy going to the hospital and holding the hands of those who are sick and pray with them. I do enjoy and have been enjoying meeting with many of you in the last few weeks. It gives me satisfaction to look for ways to make the church better. I like to learn to make my work better and to do community outreach, to feed the poor, to give water to the thirsty, to cover the naked, to be there for the elderly, to be a father to the fatherless and a mother to the motherless, to visit those in prison, by the way, who were those who were found in the wrong side of the law. We forget to make that clause. And to embrace a community that really needs the love of God today. But through the last 15 plus years that I've been in ministry, many things have happened. And at many times, I found myself being very burned out. You might be like, well, Pastor, you had a bad exit from a church that you were in. Then your divorce came around. Then my children moved to Florida. Yes, all that was difficult. After that, I never went to even step into a church. It took a lot of time of healing. But even before that, at many times, pastoring before, my work became a to-do list rather than spiritual priorities. My disciplines began to falter. I started to fall into temptation of sins such as hatred, contempt, and indifference. I built walls that separated me from God, from my family, from church, from those that I love. I remember when my daughter was newborn, I was so filled with stress and anxiety that I felt my life was collapsing. And at that time, I started working 60 to 80 hours a week, and I started ignoring everyone in my life. And I didn't realize it was a sign that I was deteriorating. When things went wrong, I was always looking for someone to blame. And after this, I entered other stages in which nothing and no one mattered to me. I stopped caring about my children. I stopped caring about my marriage. I stopped caring about my ministry. I stopped caring about my health. I stopped caring about my relationship with God. And everything was causing me pain. One day, while studying the Bible to preach, I was in my office and I felt that everything was over. I was in such a depression, I didn't care if I lived or died. And in this situation, I decided to do something that for months at that point, I had not decided to do. So I started praying. I remember this prayer, this very particular prayer, because this was a very important moment in my life. I remember that I started like fighting with God. And I was crying, I was screaming, I was feeling desperate in my depression, in my sadness, in my grief. I began to be honest to God, and I started to tell Him and tell God that I couldn't take it anymore. I started bringing things from the past, and I was telling God that I felt that I was being abandoned by His presence. And once I said that, you know, as a pastor, we want to have that very powerful, miraculous, spiritual experience. Like I said, I was literally hoping a cloud coming down and a hand writing on the wall, "I still love you." But nothing happened. God didn't say anything. So I went home. And that night, after my kids were asleep, I was making sure the doors were locked in the house and the lights were off and that everything was good, that the dogs were not barking and everything. I remember I sat on the couch and started sobbing. And I felt in my heart a comfort, as if my dad, who had died many years ago, was hugging me and embracing me. I felt in my heart a conviction that God knew. It was like God telling me, "I know what you're going through. I have been here with you all this time." And I knew that in that moment, and many moments like this after, that I wasn't alone. The story of the woman with the issue of blood in Mark 25:25-24, also represents the story of someone who was burnt out by the suffering she had been carrying for many years. She had been dealing with her condition for 12 years. Can you imagine 12 years? My son is 11, and I feel that he was born yesterday. But when I look at his life, I feel like he was born like 20 years ago because of all the experiences that I have gone through in 11 years. Can you imagine going through 12 years of just pain and suffering and being in constant depression and constant illness? She was probably trying, during that time, she probably tried various treatments from many doctors and diets and might have spent all her money in the process. And despite her efforts, her condition only worsened, leaving her physically, emotionally, and financially drained. She was burnt out. And in her desperation, she approached Jesus in an unorthodox way. She believed that by merely touching his cloak, that will heal her. So she came up behind him, and in the middle of the crowd, she touched the seam of his garment, and this unconventional act of faith was enough. She was immediately healed. And the Bible says, Jesus is like, who touched me? And the people are like, well, you're being pressed by the people. Why are you asking who touched you? And when he looked around, the Bible says that she was afraid. Afraid because she was healed. Afraid because she had touched Jesus. Afraid because she had done what no one else had done before. And Jesus came to confront her. I remember when I was a kid that my parents and my older family members and always some people at the church always taught me that God was already mad at me and that he was watching me for something I did wrong in order to punish me. So growing up, I was always terrified of doing anything and everything because I just didn't want to drop dead because God was always furious. Later in life, in seminary, I learned the famous sermon by Jonathan Edwards, Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. I love this sermon. He was clever. He thought that he wanted us to imagine God as an archer with a bow and an arrow pointing at you, waiting for the precise moment to release the arrow. Don't take me wrong. But I believe Edwards was wrong. Because I believe that the God Jesus reveals is one full of compassion. I will rename my sermon today, Sinners in the Arms of a Loving, Compassionate, and Merciful God. And that day when that woman, after touching the garment of Jesus, had been healed, she afraid and terrified because she had touched the Lord and something miraculous happened to her. When Jesus confronted her, her expectations of that encounter at that time were probably wrong, because instead of finding herself in the hands of an angry God, she found herself in the arms of a loving, merciful, and compassionate Jesus Christ, who told her, woman, your faith has healed you. In the same fashion, Jesus is here for us. We might be struggling with things that are very real and overwhelming in life, but Jesus is here for us. We might not see him because of the busyness of the lives we're living, but Jesus is here with us. We might be scared because we have created walls due to bad examples of leadership representations in the past, but Jesus is here for us. We might be afraid because of the sociopolitical condition of our society, but Jesus is here for us. Jesus is here to provide healing, to give us rest, to listen and care for us, to accept us, to love us, to embrace us and celebrate us, no matter who we are, where we come from, our race or skin color, our language, our sexuality, our gender identification, or even religion. The love of Jesus transcends all barriers and is available to everyone and anyone, no matter what. This is my closing statement for my sermon this morning. Congregational Church of Holios, Jesus is here for us. Amen. Let us celebrate the Lord one more time with him. Oh, yeah, just as I am without a plea. Thank you.
This is the time in our service where we have the opportunity to share our prayers of joy and concern. Prayer is powerful, and it's good to share with each other what's happening in our lives. I have a brief poem I'd like to read by the wonderful poet Mary Oliver, and it's titled Praying. It doesn't have to be the blue iris. It could be weeds in a vacant lot or a few small stones. Just pay attention. Then place a patch a few words together, and don't try to make them elaborate. This isn't a contest, but a doorway into thanks, and a silence in which another voice may speak. If you have a prayer of joy or concern you'd like to share, please raise your hand and I'll bring you the microphone.
I don't have either one. I just want to comment on something that the pastor said this morning. Sometimes it's not until we feel like we're all alone and we're all closed in. That's when we reach out to God.
Let this be our prayer. Lord, hear our prayer. Carol?
I like him a lot.
Prayers of joy for our strong pastoral leadership from Reverend Nathan. Let this be our prayer of joy. Lord, hear our prayer.
I do have a prayer request. On Wednesday, I'm going to have surgery in my hand. It's a small tear that I have under my right hand ring finger for doing rough things. I work out and I practice some martial arts, so I tore a muscle a few months ago and I didn't take a rest. So now I need surgery. It's something easy. It takes 10 minutes, but I have to spend the whole day in the hospital, the doctor told me. I guess they just have to make sure that I don't have any complications or anything. I'm diabetic and have a heart condition, so that probably plays into it. So just keep me in your mind. On Wednesday, I'll be going to the hospital around 11. I hope to come out, hopefully, by dinner time. So
prayers for healing for Reverend Nathan.
Thank you so much.
And prayers for all those who need healing. Let this be our prayer. Lord, hear our prayer. Carol?
Yeah. Wednesday, I'm going to have a mole on my back removed.
Prayers for healing for Anne. Let this be our prayer.
Lord
hear our prayer. Good to see you again.
I'd ask for prayers for my son. We've had a lot of death in the family, and he's just not doing well. He lost his dad, he lost his grandparents, all within a year, so he's really in a dark place.
Let this be our prayer for healing from grief. Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us have a moment of silent reflection. Let us join together and pray the prayer that our Lord Jesus Christ taught us how to pray. And we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive those who are in debt to us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we get ready for our offertory, I want to remind you today we will not be collecting an offering for Rebecca's Closet. And I want to thank you in advance for your gifts to the ministry of the United Congregational Church of Holyoke. Everything that we do is directly related to your generosity, and we're very thankful for it. Let us be ready. Generous and loving God, we bring our offering, tithes, and donations before you, gifts given from the abundance you have so graciously provided. We dedicate these offerings to your service, praying that they may be used to further your kingdom here on earth. May they bring healing to the broken, hope to the hopeless, and message of your inclusive love to all who seek you. Bless each giver and each gift, multiplying their impact in ways beyond of our understanding. Guide us in the stewardship of these resources that we do may glorify your holy name. In the spirit of the woman who reached out in faith, May we reach out those in need, extending your grace and mercy to all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us praise one more time with the hymn, There is a Balm in Gilead. As you go forth from this place, may you carry with you the assurance of God's boundless grace and healing. May you be inspired by the faith of the woman who reached out to touch Jesus' garment, knowing that there are no barriers to God's love. Go in peace, knowing you're forgiven, healed, and loved by our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you.